I'd like to take a second to introduce one of our allied partners, Sherry Skinner. So Sherry, please take it away.
Hello everybody, this is such an important topic to be here for. For those of you I don't know, I'm Sherry Skinner. I'm Client Services Manager with Interstate Moving and Storage. We're a full service moving company with our headquarters in Springfield, Virginia. We also have warehouses and dispatch from Sterling, Virginia and Landover, Maryland, so we can help all your clients in the greater area. Listening to what Rob said his safety concern was for possibly, you know, the owners. You know, you're taking a lot of pictures of people's houses, even if they're not there walking through. You're having open houses, they're walking through. These items might have some, these people might have valuable items in their home that maybe would be better if they put it into storage before you put their house on the market. So we do that for people, sometimes artwork, you know, things like that, that they just want to go ahead, and so someone's not also judging these people have a lot of money, you know, or anything like that when someone's looking at their house. Because as you know, it's often recommended that you personalize the house so that when the buyer comes in, they can see themselves there. So we have a clutter buster package, we call it. And, you know, it's not always clutter. Sometimes it's just, you know, it's nice things that need to come out very often. But they want to move to the next house, but you'd like it out of there for either safety or the house would sell faster or look bigger because these items are out of there. So I have a flyer on that. I'll have it out at my table out there. It's a flat fee of $550, two storage containers, two guys to fill the storage containers, and 2 months of storage for the flat fee of $550. We also have another program if people want to totally move out of the house because they don't like being there when someone's showing a house. You know, people are in that situation too sometimes. Or any reason they can't move from house A to B, we have up to 1 month free storage if they decide to move with us. So even if they're just have to get out of the house, close, then they move back into the next house, we wouldn't charge a truckload for that. So that would work for this free storage offer as well. Or if they need 8 months of storage or 3 months of storage, the first month of storage would not be charged for. Again, I'm Sherry Skinner with Interstate Moving and Storage.
Wait. So you're the sponsor.
One of them, yes.
You're one of the reasons I'm here.
Yes.
I love you. Okay. And I have a question. I keep hearing stories about moving scams. Can you address that briefly?
Yes. So there are bad characters in the moving industry, and that's why it's really important that you have two or three people that you have a relationship with and you know that their company is an honorable company. Often, sellers that are going to move or buyers that are moving will go online and they end up talking to a broker. It'll look like they work for a company, Ally, United, whatever, but it'll really be a moving broker. What that broker does is he's going to give them an estimate on their move, and then he's going to, or he or she, I shouldn't say he, are going to tell them this is how much your move is, but then they go out and try to sell that move to all these different movers that are buying these moves, whoever these movers are. And then it's possible that nobody buys that move from them. And then someone doesn't show up, your seller or your buyer thinks someone's coming on June 11th, and then they find out on June 11th no one's showing up at the door. The other thing that some of the bad characters do is hold people's items for ransom. I'm sure everybody's heard of that story too. So they pick up your items, they say your move's this much, then they say, nope, you owe us $5,000, $6,000 more, we're not going to deliver your items.
Wow. So the solution is called Interstate?
Interstate Moving and Storage. Contact me directly. I will hook your clients up with a move consultant to give them a free estimate.
I've got a testimonial. Do the microphone thing? Okay, yeah, I have a testimonial. Jamie knows I also do carpet cleaning. So I showed up at this client's house in Vienna. Things are out on the front lawn, they're moved out, they're calling their mover, they're not showing up, and they were scrambling, they had to be at Richmond, and they have nowhere to go. There's storm clouds coming, I see the forecast, and I called several people, you guys picked up the phone, you guys showed up with the truck, you guys came and loaded them up, they were in Richmond that night, I got a nice card, that's all I needed, but I appreciate you saving the day.
Oh, thank you very much. I feel like that just I'm glad you're able to do that. We can't always do something on a little day. But that's wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you, Sherry, very much, and especially for the information. I'd like to introduce our next allied partner, Shireen. Come on up.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Shireen, for those of you who don't know me. I'm with NBA Settlement Group, and we absolutely love partnering with NBAR, bringing information like this, because your safety is very important to all of us, obviously. And I'm sure you know NBA Settlement Group been in business for 28 years. We're licensed in and expert in all three jurisdictions, Virginia, Maryland, D.C. And as far as the wire fraud, we have everything covered. You never have to worry about anything with MBA, but of course, there's things going on, like you said, online. We have the bank shop for the EMD. We've done the research. We know what works and what's secure. So if you have any questions, give me a call and let me know, and I'll make sure everything is taken care of. And I don't want to take much of your time.
Wait,
I know you guys
can tell me again your company.
MBA Settlement Group. So we do the closings.
Oh.
So when realtors do all the hard work and get the ratified contract, we're from contract to close. We'll take care of everything and bring everybody to a celebration of closing that settlement and popping champagne. Basically an extension to your team.
You guys do the title insurance?
Yes, the title insurance.
Okay,
yes.
Wonderful. I like that you're safety aware, and thank you again for helping.
Of course, thank you.
Okay,
have a good one. Oh,
thank you very much. We can't do these events without our sponsors, so we really appreciate everything that you do for us. Now I want to introduce Tracey, the safety lady Hawkins, who is going to tell us all about how to be safe in all the various ways that you've addressed earlier. She is a former real estate agent, so realize that she's coming from a point of experience. And she's taught thousands of agents across the country to live and work safely for over 27 years. She has a very long list of accolades, but since we are running late, I will let her continue. No, that's all right. But I just want to introduce, we're really excited to have her. She spoke at NBAR this year, or sorry, NAR this year, which is how we found her and why she joined us. So Seth, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Everyone, I have to apologize. I've been doing this a long time. I've never had a technical hiccup like I did this morning, causing a delay. And I want to thank the staff, you guys, fabulous, for getting us back on track. It's not the presentation that it's supposed to be, but I should be able to think on my feet after 27 years, right? Okay, I am, again, Tracey, the safety lady, and I have the honor of traveling the country doing this. I was just in D.C. for the RIS Media Newsmaker Awards, and I was happy to be in the Crusader category, so that was fabulous. And this is my busy month. This is September's Real Estate Safety Month, so I'm everywhere from California to Iowa to Texas, some virtually, some in real life, but I love what I do, and I'm happy to be here. And that it just worked out perfectly. Your leadership team is fabulous for finding a way to get me here. So the question is, why am I here? The National Association of Realtors has mandated that all associations and boards must have some kind of safety training. And what I appreciate in your leadership here is that they want a true subject matter expert. One of my biggest challenges, and if you deal with FSBOs, you understand how everybody thinks they can do what you do, right? And then it's just easy, put a sign in the door, it's easy. Same thing in my business. People think that they can do what I do. I've been doing this for a long time, so I appreciate when your leadership here says, we want you, Tracey, and let's make it happen. There are a lot of stories about crimes against real estate agents. Most people have no clue what's going on. So I started a Facebook group where I talk about nothing but real estate safety. That's where I share stories of crimes against agents, not only that, but solutions. That's where I share my articles. That's where you come to find out what's happening and to get information and resources. My biggest challenge in this business is getting people to see the value of what I talk about. I contacted an education director a few years back, and she said, Tracey, I'd love to have you. She said, but it's not good business. It's like, what are you talking about? She said, if you don't teach real estate agents how to make more money, they won't show up for training. True?
No.
Kind of, right? Okay, so I had to put on my thinking cap. It's like, how do I make safety profitable? So I created my own designation, and I've had more than, I want to say, 700 agents completed, where I'm teaching agents specifically how to make more money being safe, but most importantly, by protecting the consumer. And that's one of the things that, one of the reasons that you're members of NAR
the whole ethical standards, and you know, part of your core standard is that you have to do some kind of community work. And I truly believe that protecting the consumer is the way to make you all stand out from all of the other agents, and it's core to what you do. Who here is familiar with the Beverly Carter story? Who's comfortable enough to briefly, succinctly summarize the Beverly Carter story? Okay, right, you have. Okay. I told you guys we're going to be movement today. Okay, so what I'd like you to do is to briefly summarize. Oh, she's here. Just briefly summarize the story.
I actually saw her son speak about it. So Beverly met some buyers at a house in Arkansas, and they ended up putting her in the trunk. I don't remember exactly all the details, sorry, how I started. And they looked like they were valid buyers with a lot of money. She made an appointment, I believe, with the wife, but then a man was there too. And they ended up kidnapping her, and ultimately she was not recovered.
Thank you. Thank you very much. She does that way. Okay, Beverly Carter, as she said, was a real estate agent in Little Rock. Beverly got a phone call from a buyer who said he was a cash buyer. Being a former agent, you know what happens when you hear cash buyer, right? You set that appointment to go. And then she started, after she set the appointment, she started thinking about it. It's like, wait a minute, I've got a bad feeling. And the reason I know that is I had an opportunity to interview her office mate. Her office mate said after she made that appointment, she started thinking, this is dangerous, this is scary. She picked up the phone and she called him back. She said, look, I'm not comfortable meeting with you alone. He said, don't worry, my wife will be there too. And we now know, of course, it was his accomplice. So she showed up, and it was just him. He said, my wife had to work, you know, let's just do the FaceTime, and she'll just follow along with us. Those were the last images on Beverly's phone. But he ended up, like you said, kidnapping her, and then her body was found a few days later. As a result, her family sued the real estate company for negligence. They said if there was safety training, they believed Beverly would be here now. So I put on my thinking cap again, and I created a training program to teach brokers, managers, and owners how to not get sued successfully, how to set up safety practices within your office, the four walls, the equipment, the people, not just the agents, and how to set up safe real estate practices. Got a question for you all. Who can name a risk involved in the jobs that you do? What is a risk involved with being a real estate agent?
Robbed.
Say again?
Robbed.
Robbed. You can get robbed. Okay, give me one, two more.
Right.
A risk involved in your job. Think about what you do right here.
Kidnapped.
We want everyone to hear you.
I think my experience, I have to deal with the dogs.
Oh, dogs?
Yeah. Yes. They are in the house and you don't know even they're in the house.
I read an article about that. You have to deal with dogs. Excellent point. Okay, one more. Let's do one more.
Injury that can come from any
getting other. Injured. Okay. Let's take a look. Your job description reads that you meet complete strangers in empty houses. You sit in empty houses and you wait for strangers to walk in. How does that sound? I'm not saying it. You say it. Okay. Did you all know that the U.S. Department of Labor considers real estate sales and leasing a high-risk, hazardous occupation?
Yes.
Think about the job description. There's no argument, right? So they put you up there with the convenience store clerk, the taxi, the Uber driver, security guards, law enforcement officials. My job is not to scare you, but to give you the tools that you need in order to do your jobs in a safe manner. Last year, I got an opportunity to speak at the NAR conference, and they wanted me to talk about lessons learned, to talk about crimes against real estate agents. What I'm going to do today, since we're limited in time, I want you all to know that there have been stories about crimes against real estate agents past Beverly Carter. Some people think after Beverly Carter, nothing else has happened. Again, lessons learned. If you know what's happening amongst your peers, that's going to make you be a little more alert. A real estate agent was killed evicting tenants. A real estate agent in Colorado was standing in a room. The guy who was looking at the property pulled out a knife and a can of bear spray. She pulled out her gun. She shot at him. She survived. Lesson learned there is if you have a weapon, have it accessible, and don't be afraid to use it. In California, a real estate agent had a client in, or someone was in that previous weekend. She had a bad feeling about him. He came back the next weekend, and at that point, she said, no, you are not here to see the house. You have to go. If you look at that picture, the blurred out image is her. Look at that grassy area to the left. When he came into the house, she told him he had to leave. So she had him go outside. He pushed her down in that grassy patch and he assaulted her. So the lessons learned there is, number one, she was not afraid to say, you're not here to see the house, you must go. She was not worried about hurting his feelings. She said, you have to go. And number two, she knew there was a camera out there. She got him in front of the camera so his image could be captured. After he pushed her down, she was yelling and screaming and yelling and screaming, and I can still hear her voice. She knew that criminals are cowards and they don't want attention. He eventually left her alone and he was captured. You can read, I wrote an article about it for Realtor magazine, and I talked about six things that she did right to survive. I'm going to make sure you all have a link to get that story. In Virginia, a real estate agent was attacked. The guy came into the house. He hit her in the head and face and neck area about 10 times. With a wrench. She happened to be a black belt. The lesson learned there is, if you're going to get any kind of physical self-defense training, one class is not enough. You need to take the class over and over and make sure you know exactly what you're doing. Again, the one class, I took a class, now I know what I'm doing, not enough. She was a black belt. You don't have to go to that level. She was able to defend herself and get out of that situation. Exact same thing that happened to Beverly happened to Monique Bao, New Year's Eve 2020. Exact same thing. She got a call from a stranger. She showed up to meet them. He kidnapped her and he killed her. The lesson learned there is what? Say again.
Meet your client in an office first before you show them.
Yeah, exactly. Meet them first, and that's for witness potential. We'll talk about that. I can't go through all of the crimes, and that's sad. And we don't know all of them. Two guys tried to kidnap an agent in the front yard in Omaha. This real estate agent, same thing as the first one, went to a property that he was managing to get paperwork, and he was killed. His body was hidden in the crawl space. In Florida, real estate agent was robbed at gunpoint when he was out front. The guy took him to two ATMs, took his back, he was leaving a property, took $1,000 from the ATM and then shot and killed him. A real estate agent in Tennessee was robbed at gunpoint when he was showing his clients a house. He was opening the lockbox and the client approached with a gun and said, give me, you know, run for your life. And this agent actually thought about it. Do I try to take this kid on who's a teenager, or do I run? He chose to run. He also happened to have his car keys, he threw them. And then what happened is he ran, he saved his life, and his car keys, the criminal decided to take his vehicle. He happened to have his iPad in the car with the location enabled. He was able to track it and he got his vehicle back. Lesson learned there is utilize technology, and his gut said, run, don't try to take this kid on, listen to your body. This real estate agent was killed when he was trying to evict, went to his property in California. A home inspector and two real estate agents were shot. The two agents were wounded. The home inspector was killed when the siblings who were going to sell the house were in a debate about whether to sell or not, so they came into a hostile situation. The question on this one has been in the news. This real estate agent with his clients showed up at a property. A neighbor thought they were burglarizing the property, and they called the police. The police came, they saw him there, and with his clients there, and you all remember the video, he came out with his hands up, his hands cuffed behind his back, until he was able to convince the police that he was actually a real estate agent. So the question I have to ask you all is, how do you prevent having the police called on you when you go to see a property? He just pulled up, he was showing a property. He never imagined that at the end of the day he would be on TV with his hands in the air and handcuffed and guns drawn on him. So the neighbor thought she saw a burglary. So my question to you, has anyone here ever had the police called on them?
Yeah, all the time.
You have?
Not call, but show up.
Oh, okay. Anyone? And I don't think I mentioned I have a twin sister. She and I got our licenses together 34, 35 years ago. She's still an agent. She had the police call when they tripped an alarm. But I've had people, I posted it on social media, and yes, a question here, let's get the microphone to you, but I posted it on social media. I heard from people of all colors, male, female, who've had the police call for one reason or the other. Neighbors see, and they call the police, yes.
Yeah, I have a question about the eviction being attacked, the agent trying to evict the tenant's son, maybe. My question is why they don't, like, we have the same situation, my wife and I. But what we do is we go through the court and get police to do that for us instead of
it. What I think, and those two stories, one is this was during the eviction moratorium, and tempers were running high in that situation, and we don't know if he was going to evict him, but the tenant did kill him. In other stories, they're just simply visiting the property. But you're right, there are safe ways to do evictions, and I had to create a whole program about property management safety. So, excellent point. The latest crime against the latest murder of a real estate agent was this real estate agent. He sold the house sight unseen to an 85-year-old client during the pandemic. The client moved into the house first time he saw it, and then he decided he wanted to return the house. He called the agent. The agent went over. He shot and killed the agent. Then he turned the gun and killed himself. And I got an opportunity at the NAR conference last year to talk to an agent close to the situation. She said the way to solve that problem is to simply make them show up in person before you sign or close anything. That way there are no questions about it. Okay, and then the most recent crime against an agent happened last month in Las Vegas. I don't know if you all saw the news. A real estate agent was in an open house. A guy came in. She was a little uncomfortable, so he ended up leaving. She got herself locked. She locked the doors, locked herself in the closet. He got back in the house. He kicked the door open, got back into the house. He pulled her out of the closet and was assaulting her. She was on the phone with help. So crimes are happening on a regular basis, and my goal is not to ever blame the victim, but to learn lessons from those crimes. So let us talk about, and I'm so lost on time. When do we need to take our break?
I think, no, keep going. We're good until 1.
Okay, so we'll take a break at 1.
So we got lunch.
Oh,
yeah, we're going to take a lunch break. We started about 15 minutes late, so 15
minutes. 12:15?
So it's 11:45 now.
So, yeah, so break at noon or break?
Yeah, break at
noon.
Okay, 15 more minutes.
Okay, okay. I need people have to tell me when to stop.
I'll
play. Okay, because I can do this all day. And as a matter of fact, I have. So I just 15 minutes. Okay, so my job is to teach you how to be safe and how to build business by protecting the consumer. So can you become the local safety expert? Can you be the real estate agent who is looking out for the safety of the consumer? That's how you stand apart. I wrote an article for The Close, and again, I'll make sure you all have a link to find the article where I am telling you how to do it. Today, I have short time, so I'm going to summarize it for you. I was going to talk about, and I typically talk about hitchhikers, but after the pandemic, I don't think any of you all are giving anyone rides in your car, am I right? No one's getting in, right? Okay, so we don't need to talk about that part.
No.
Okay, I don't know why this is a delay.
You save 2 minutes.
Clicking through. I don't know why we're having a delay. There we are. Okay. Don't judge a book by its cover.
Point to that side, how about?
What, say again?
By the dongle, which is...
Where am I supposed to point it, up there?
By the computer.
Oh, of course, I'm all over here. Okay, I can say I was a technology expert. I'm just a safety girl. Okay, don't judge a book by its cover. I can't tell you how many times I've heard people say, oh, I can tell if someone means me harm. I can look them up or down. You know, I can tell. I am telling you not to judge a book by its cover because it could cost you business or it could get you hurt. I used to ask the question of give me a physical characteristic of someone that you're uncomfortable either walking into your open house, getting out of the car to see a property, but I stopped asking that question. No one would answer it. So my question to you is, let's say you are the agent who can judge a book by its cover. So let's say you have an upscale listing. Let's say this fella here showed up at your upscale luxury listing. Let's say you are the agent who can judge a book by its cover. Does anyone know who that is? Sam Walton, founder of Walmart.
Yes.
You look at him and you think, I'm not wasting my time. He can't afford anything here, right? One of the richest men in the world. You can't judge a book by its cover. Who knows who that is? Ted Bundy, notorious serial killer. How did they describe Ted Bundy?
Charming,
charismatic, good-looking, clean-cut, right? If you judge that book by its cover, it would cost you your life. You can't judge a book by its cover, so don't try. So you're saying, Tracy, how am I supposed to know if someone means me harm? If you judge, look at this cute little, sweet little lady. Just regular, everyday people. Those are all serial killers. Oprah used to have a guest on named Gavin DeBecker. He wrote a book called The Gift of Fear, and it talked about fear signals that we all possess. Who knows what the gift of fear that we all possess that can keep us safe in any circumstance? Who knows what that is?
Intuition.
Say it.
Yeah, gut.
Your gut. Mm-hmm. Gut, instinct, intuition, sixth sense, flight or flight. I've even heard it called spidey sense. No matter what you call it, say it.
Spidey sense.
Right. No matter what you call it, every animal in nature is born with that instinct, that voice, whose sole job is to protect
us. That's his only job. Every animal has it. Human beings are the only animals who ignore it. Why do we ignore it?
We're not animals.
We're not. We are animals. So we're not animals. We are animals.
Another topic. Go ahead.
All the same, all of us have that voice, and if we listen to the voice, it could keep us out of danger, keep us out of trouble. But so often, in the interest of being polite, we just don't want to hurt someone's feelings. We ignore it. And that voice is a warning signal. Beverly Carter heard it when she questioned it. The agent who had to decide if he's going to take the guy on heard it, and they listened to it. The other, all of those stories, agents heard the voice. In some of those stories, agents heard the voice. So what I'm telling you today, if you hear nothing else, you must listen to the voice whose sole job is to keep you safe. No other job, no other agenda, but to keep you safe. That book ought to be required reading. So let's talk about creating a safety plan. And the most important thing about creating a safety plan is consistency. If you have a plan, you need to do it on a regular basis. The one time you veer off the plan is when trouble comes. So let's talk about it. And again, I don't have time to go through those tips that could save your life. So I will direct you to the close where you can find the article that I've written there. When we talk about dressing, I don't have to tell you to dress professionally. Real estate agents are some of the best dressed people, but I have to tell you to dress safely. That means men, that means women, that means save your fancy, expensive jewelry for special occasions. I had an agent who was a kindergarten teacher, and she had retired and she got her license. She said, I'm so excited now I get to wear my fancy jewelry, my high heel shoes that I couldn't wear in the class. Absolutely not. You already have a bullseye on you. So the goal is to dress in a safe manner. Fancy stuff for special occasions. Ladies, high heel shoes look good on, but they're hard to run in. So imagine situations that we talked about, real estate agents who've been able to get out of a dangerous situation. Hard to do in heels, and it's sad to have to talk about. We're talking about shoes in a business situation. I was in Knoxville, and I had an agent take off her stiletto. She held it up. She said, this is my weapon, and I know how to use it. So she would use her heel as a weapon. Everyone's not as inclined. So in that situation, think about being in a room or a space and having to get out in a hurry. You're in your cars a lot. What if you're stuck on the side of the road and you need to walk for help? Hard to do in high heel shoes. So keep that in mind. I'm going to show you a list. Look in each box. Tell me what you notice. Tell me if you see a theme. Look at each name. Look in each box.
All guys.
Look at these two. What's the theme?
Men.
They're all men.
Yes.
All male agents. Really quickly, David Abbasi was a real estate agent in Atlanta who was killed while showing property. Ryan Vega, an agent in Las Vegas who was stabbed in the neck. Both of those during Safety Month of 2016. Sidney Cranston Jr.'s body was found after being missing for 18 months after he showed someone who he didn't know. Lane Gamble, an agent sitting in front of a property in North Carolina who had a gun put to his head while he was sitting in the car waiting for his client. Brian is a real estate agent in Washington who had his wife waiting for him in the car. He went inside and he was ambushed and beaten. And if you look at the NAR safety videos, that's his story. You'll see him with the bloody part on the top of his head telling his story. Frank Wayman, a broker owner in Missouri in a small town who let someone in the office and they presented a machete. And I don't know, I robbed him, but they presented a machete. And David Stokoe is the real estate agent who was evicting a tenant in the very first story that I showed you. And then the others are the ones that we talked about. All of them are male agents. So when I look around and see males in my programs, I am grateful that you all show up. Too often I've had male agents say, oh, this is for the women. I had a male agent get up and leave the room when he heard what the topic was going to be. And it's like, you're the one who needs to be here. All of the recent crimes against real estate agents in the past 2 years have been the male agents. For some weird reason, until the Las Vegas crime last week, that was a female agent. So for whatever reason, they are targeting male agents. And I had an opportunity to write an article for Realtor magazine, and it was the most read article of the year back in 2017 because no one was talking about it. And I interviewed male agents. It's like, why do you guys not think the safety applies to you? I heard the machismo factor. I heard because, you know, how many times do I have to hear, I'm 6'2", 225 pounds? Try to get a female agent to say her weight, right? But that's the first thing they say, I'm a big guy.
No one's going to bother me. And then I heard an agent, he said, we're just stupid. We just don't think it's going to happen. And again, I'll give you a link to find those articles. I also wrote for RIS Media an article about the most recent agent crimes against agents, and I just don't talk about the crimes. We talk about actionable practices, how to prevent those crimes from happening. One thing that I do is that I tape myself, and when I look back at the tape, I realize that I don't breathe between sentences. And I think I'm doing that today. And I'm also, I talk fast, so if I'm going too fast, I need you all to slow me down. Part of me is trying to make up some time, but the other part is I need to make sure you can understand what I'm saying. So if I go too fast, don't do what my agent did in Oklahoma. She did the evaluation. She said, Tracey talked so fast it made me dizzy. I don't want you to be dizzy, I want you to hear me, so let me know. One of the benefits of being a real estate agent is you're independent contractors. You come and go as you please. No one tells you what to do, no one tells you where to go. That can also be a detriment. Somebody needs to know where you are at all times. The National Association of Realtors created some forms, agent itinerary form, agent information form, the client information form. If you go to the NAR.realtor website, one of the articles that I wrote has links in it to those forms so you don't have to search all over. So that's where you can get the information. And one of the most important forms there is the agent information form. That's where you put your any health issues, allergies, or any health issues that may impact you when you're working or you're in your office, your emergency contact information, and, are you saying 5 minutes?
No.
Oh.
Let's comment when you're done.
Oh, go ahead.
Somebody had mentioned, you know, you're talking about knowing where mm-hmm. people are, and you had mentioned knowing that there was a proactive way you accidentally would text your broker. Homestat, Safety Time, Century Lock, Showtime, all these have those proactive ways. And I have asked all my agents to always add me as a contact, and I don't care if it's an accident. I'd much rather hear from them and make sure they're in place and that they're okay. You know, and one thing I think after hearing this, I'm going to add in there is a safety word of some sort, because everybody can say I'm okay, but we got to work in that safety word somehow so that they actually know. But I think don't worry about if you bother your broker, that's their job. Okay.
So that
is on Homestat, Century Lock. All those will actually do it, and those are all. What do we say with forewarn? It's proactive. You're checking before you meet, whereas these other ones are more of a response or reactive situation.
Yeah.
So just be aware of the difference between those two.
Yeah. One of the things I have is my buddy. I just call him up and say, hey, yeah, I want to order a pizza for lunch.
There you go.
He knows that I never order pizzas right now.
Okay. So that's your distress signal, your code word.
Yeah.
And I love that. The problem is when people are using the red file. Do you guys remember hearing about the red file?
Yeah.
That the red. She's like, yeah, but right. The red file used to be the code word, I'm in trouble, you know, hello, can you send me the red file? The problem with that is everybody has to be on board. There was a real estate agent in Raleigh, Missouri, who they had the red file situation in their office. So she was showing a new client, she was going to show him 3 houses. So they get to the first house, and in the first house, he rapes her. He said, we're going to the next house, and we're going to do it again. And the next day, she said, wait, I've got to call my office first, you know, and make sure everything's okay. And then, so they get to the second, and then she called, and she says, I need the red file. The person who answered the phone said, what are you talking about? They went to the second house, and coincidentally, another agent showed up to look at the property. She took off, leaving that agent with the rapist, but she was able to escape the situation. Lesson learned, don't let it be the red file. Everyone across the country knows what a red file is, so that's why I like yours. You make it different, make it unique, something that no one has a clue, because if he knows, or he or she, whoever the perpetrator is, knows that you're calling for help, they're not going to be happy. So good point. Agent information form, make sure you fill that out. Your broker needs to have that information in case something happens to you, whether you're in the office and you fall out, they need to know if you have allergies or a diabetic situation. So make sure you update that, and it also allows you to update the emergency contact as well as the make and model of your vehicle. If law enforcement officials need to be able to find out what kind of car you're driving, let your broker or manager be able to have that information. So we're going to talk about, we're going to take our lunch break, and then after lunch break, the rest of this program is going to be about technology, so.
Tracey, I want to interject one thing because it goes with this topic. It must have been 3-4 years ago, the Safety Month, they had a podcast going on. So you need to go back and search for that particular podcast. And in there is a Michelle, I forget what her last name is, but she does a 911 call with an eight, she practices this. And she does a 911 call acting as if she's calling the office. And you can listen to this audio go along, and eventually the 911 operator catches on what's happening and dispatches somebody. But you have to practice this. It's a script, you have to practice it, it has to sound natural. But I recommend everyone go find that podcast that NVAR did and listen to that audio and implement that, because that is you necessarily to your brokerage, you can go to 911. If you're in dire straits, get it taken care of right away. So we'll see if we can get a link added to whoever sends out stuff with Tracey. Okay?
So yeah, we're gonna break for lunch.
Anyhow,
Tracey, why don't you get us started in the second half? Thank you.
Okay,
I
hope you're not on that.
No.
Okay.
Am I on now?
Yeah.
Okay, so what I wanted to do is, in the interest of time, is to make sure I cover everything that I'm supposed to cover, but I wanted to go back to some of the questions, some of the concerns that you all had at the very beginning. I heard more than one of you talk about having fears or not feeling safe at open houses, correct? So let's talk about open house safety for a bit. Now, one thing that you have to be, and I'm operating off of a slide that it may come up, but I want to cover it just in case it doesn't. So let's talk about open house safety. One of the biggest issues that you have to worry when hosting an open house is you have to be concerned about fair housing laws. You don't want to get on the wrong side of a complaint. So with an open house, that's kind of contrary to being able to determine who can come and go. I was in North Dakota, and I had an agent say that if I'm hosting an open house, even if I feel uncomfortable, if someone comes in and I'm scared, I have to let them stay there and I have to show them because I don't want to get in trouble. Is that true?
No.
If you are scared and frightened, do you have the right to refuse someone entry into your open house? I don't hear any answers.
Yes.
Yeah, your gut will tell you, and then you need to do whatever it takes to be safe. And no one's going to argue with that. So I'm going to share a few stories about open houses. And it just so happens in these stories that the agent happened to be female and the maybe would-be perpetrator happened to be a male. So first story, an agent was hosting an open house and then she sees a car pull up and a guy gets out, a late model car, nice clean cut looking guy gets out, and then all of a sudden she's got this feeling in the pit of her stomach, something is wrong, red flags are just firing everywhere. So she got up and she locked the door. And the guy comes up, he rings the doorbell, he's knocking on the door, and she says through the door, I am closed for the day. He said, no, you're not, I just saw someone leave. She said, I am closed now. So what she did right in that situation, her gut told her that this is going to be a problem. She closed to everybody. She didn't wait for someone to come along who looked okay and let them in. She would have gotten in trouble, right? She was closed to every single person. The other story is a real estate agent. She saw, again, a late model car driver. Criminals know how to present themselves where they don't look in the, what we expect, the trench coat and the scruffy look. They know how to present themselves and they assimilate. So she saw a late model car, again, a clean cut, nice looking guy, get out. And she had this voice that something was wrong. So what she did is she said, go ahead and look at the house. I'm going to stand out on the porch. I need to make a phone call. So that is when she made a pretend phone call. She spoke loud enough when he walked in so he could hear her. She said, look, you're almost here. You know, you're just a couple of blocks away. So she was giving the impression that she was talking to someone who was almost there. She said he walked into the house. He realized that she wasn't coming in. He turned and left. He walked past her on the porch, didn't say a word. He was not there to see the house. So what you need to do is create a witness. So let's say you're hosting an open house and you feel uncomfortable. In that situation, you can have the person sign the log, the register, and if they're criminal, of course, they're going to write down false information, right? But this is when you are observing them. You're going to be able to give information to law enforcement officials if necessary. The height, the weight, not the color of the clothes. They can take the clothes or a cap or anything off, but you're looking for distinguishing marks. So you need to be able to describe them to law enforcement officials. You can also give the impression that you're not alone. So someone comes in, you can say, look, I've got someone in the basement. I hope they don't disturb you. I've got someone coming around the corner. They have four kids. I hope they don't get in your way. Give the impression that you're not alone. My sister used to sit in a new housing subdivision, and she said, I feel like a sitting duck. So that's why you create witnesses, so that it appears that you're not alone. I heard two people talk about not going in basements.
Tracy, can I throw out one other suggestion?
Yes.
You have allied partners. All of your offices have partners. You have title partners. You have lenders. They'll do open houses with you. Don't be afraid to ask those people to help you with your open houses.
And I, that's what I say. No one ever has to do an open house alone. Where's my Wells Fargo guy? Right here. If one of these agents in this room asked you to co-host an open house with them, what would you say?
Absolutely.
You'll probably do backflips, right?
It's like you're moving one time.
Right. There's never, ever, ever an excuse to not have someone accompany you. Thank you for bringing that up. Never an excuse, because it's in their best interest too. And I had the general counsel, a former general counsel of NAR, I saw her talking about safety, and she said one thing would solve crimes against real estate agents. One simple thing. Can anyone tell me what that might be?
The buddy system. The buddy system, having somebody else with you.
Say again?
The buddy system.
The buddy, yeah, yeah. The bottom line, never work alone.
Yeah.
Never work alone.
You can hire a hostess. Seriously, if you need, you know, if you don't want to let another agent in on what you're doing or whatever, fine. Hire a hostess.
Right.
And I've been doing this 45 years, and I quit doing open houses by myself probably 35 years ago. I had somebody with me, even if it was in my own neighborhood.
Yeah, I mean, you don't know.
There truly is safety in numbers. And like, what's your name?
Clary. Yeah, take Larry from
the shoe. Oh, okay. He will never, ever allow you to do an open house alone. Never an excuse. And when it's showing, what about asking a new agent to accompany you so they can get the experience? Never an excuse. Yes?
Tracy, I recently have an open house. I asked my broker. I want to ask somebody to join me. Mm-hmm. My broker told me I need to give a license. People join me.
No. That's not true.
I know that's not true. As long as they're not interacting or talking about the property, you can have a spouse come, sit on the couch, read the newspaper. They can't interact or talk about the property. Anybody, an adult can go, no kids, this is not the time for you to take kids. Okay, another comment here.
What about rentals? Because I do a lot of investment for investors, and the, you know, the places are being rented. There are very few people that come into the office and then go back out to see them.
One of the things,
usually by yourself.
One of the things that's different about the rental community than the real estate community is if you want to see a property, you have to do one thing before you even show up. That's why you don't hear so many stories about crimes against leasing agents. What is the one thing that you must do before you show them a property? You get their ID, right?
No, most of these people are just they want to show up at the property and see the property. Then it won't be rented.
You did pre-screening. It's really important to do some sort of pre-screening before you why waste your time showing a rental if somebody's not qualified for it anyway?
Right, so and there are, and then we'll talk about, what is it, virtual showings, self-showings. So that's almost the same thing, but we'll talk about self-showings. But for rentals, again, you have to take the extra step. During the eviction moratorium, my sister happens to be a landlord, or they call themselves housing providers now. And the tenant movement was very strong in Kansas City and across the country. So everyone was painting landlords, property managers as the bad guys. They're profiteers, and they're all evil because they won't let them live for free. So my sister was getting threats, a guillotine, and she was getting threats. So she and her husband owned their own property, so they had to take extra measures when they were evicting. They would get a team. We talked about that. They would get a team before they could evict. Don't go by yourself. And they would all of a sudden started carrying weapons, legal weapons, where they were showing. So you have to do what it takes to stay safe, and that environment still exists for landlords. So she's still somewhat in danger. She, of course, is out front and center with NAR talking about property rights. So you do need to take proper steps in that situation. Okay, let us move on. And before it's over, we're going to talk about those self-showings, which became really popular during the pandemic, and those have a whole set of characteristics on their own. Someone needs to know where you are at all times. So the question is, how do you make that happen? Simple and easy enough to text your location to someone, just, hey, I'm going to be showing at a certain time. Your phone can be a safety tool, whether you have Android or you have an Apple phone. Has anyone here ever lost their phone? For the first time in my life, I lost my phone. Okay, so we talk about ways to stay safe and ways to let someone know where we are. Google Maps is already on your phone if you use Google Maps. Who uses Google Maps? I can't live without it. Even around town, just for the fun of it, I activate Google Maps, right? And then I travel a lot, I like to drive. So what you can do with Google Maps is make sure someone knows your location. So when you type in where you're going to go, you have an option there where it says share your location. So you can see there's my sister there. I choose her. So I will say Stacy has access to see where I am. So with my Google Maps on my phone, I am now giving her permission to see where I am in real time. Now what I can do is I can limit how long she can see my location. I had an agent who said she leaves it on 24/7, that way her husband can see where she is, she doesn't have to think about it. I had another agent, he said there's no way he wants his wife to know where he is at all times, because he may be on the golf course and she thinks he's working. So you can limit the time that someone can see your location. How many of you all use Google Calendar, a shared calendar with your office? The shared calendar is ideal. If someone in your office knows where you're supposed to be and who you're going to be with, then they can see your location. So if you don't show up when you're supposed to, they can look in real time. They can take an extra step and look at street view and take a look at the outside of the property or wherever you are so that they can see exactly where you are. So you need to make sure someone knows your location at all times. When I lost my phone, never ever happened to me before. When I lost my phone, I decided to track my phone. So I went to Google and I said, find my device. And what it does is it gave me a timeline of everywhere that I had been. And I remember thinking that was so invasive when Google first started tracking people, when you would check in, and it's like, now I can see the benefit. And I drive a lot. So it gave me a map as well as a timeline of everywhere that I had been. When I learned that I could not find my phone, either the battery died or they turned it off or took the battery out, I went to Google and I said, erase my device. So if you lose your phone and you have client information on your phone and you panic and you want to make sure no one can access that information if they find your phone, it's as simple as sitting at your computer and telling Google to erase your device. So now they have a phone, but your information is not on it. Google Maps is growing, and one thing that they're doing is they're asking us to help them. If you ever see something like a traffic accident, they ask you to report it. So if you're going somewhere, you'll say, hey, there's an accident ahead. You know, you can take an alternate route. So that involves us helping them. So when you see that prompt to share the information, go ahead and share it. One thing they also do is they also are going to start sharing if there's like a mass shooting somewhere, that you can report it in the app. So if you're on your way somewhere and there's a crime occurring or something along those lines, your app, the Google Maps app, is going to tell you. So they're working on that. Let's talk about that first time meeting. I told you about the situation in California where the siblings were in a debate about whether or not to sell their property. And then the agent and the two agents and the home inspector showed up, and then they were involved in the whole shootout situation because the brother didn't want to sell, so he shot all of them. Again, he killed the home inspector and wounded the agents. During the pandemic, so many places closed, including Kansas City and other places across the country. And I know you all didn't close here, but some places, in order to stay in business, you were forced to go online. And that actually happened to my business as well. If you wanted to stay in business and if you wanted to stay sane and social, you had to become virtual. So this is where a first-time meeting, it used to be CITO coming to the office, but even back then, agents weren't doing it, no matter how many times I said it, no matter how many times any safety expert told them to have them go into the office first. What is the purpose of having your new client show up for a first meeting before you go to the property?
Other people see them.
Witness potential, exactly. The goal is, if they're cowards, they don't want to be seen. Think about the Monique Bowles situation. Think about the Beverly Carter situation. They met them alone in the property, but there were no witnesses, no one to stop them. So the first time meeting lets them know that, first of all, our safety practices or our safety standards or my company, my team, you know, our policy dictates that we meet our client first. So the goal is you're going to meet them in advance. Virtual first meetings were necessary, they were required. Now, they can do two things. One is they can keep you safe. Virtually, they know that their image is going to be captured on a screen, so if they're going to do something, they're less likely to do it because someone can see them. Number two, it can help you be more productive. Think about how you can just share a screen and show some of the properties that you want to show them instead of taking the time to jump in the car, pay, what, $20 a gallon for gas, and drive all over, and they don't want to see the property. So if you show them on the screen, here are some houses that I would like you to take a look at. Think how many houses you can eliminate by just sharing it on the screen. So that can help you be more productive. And then you can assess the temperament of who you're meeting. Are they motivated? Or is there a hostile situation? I was just, I was in Iowa. And I had some agents say, that there was a husband and wife, they were divorcing, and she went to go to the meeting, and they were fighting, and it was awful, and she was feared for her danger to the point where she had to call the police because they were trying to drag her into it. So if you had a virtual first meeting, you could see if there are going to be issues so that you can plan accordingly. Either take someone with you or you can have the choice to turn them down. So that's the way that technology is important. Let's talk about ways to help you stand out on that seller listing presentation. How can you get an edge over the other agents who they interviewed first? So if I ask you all a question, what is it that you do that makes you stand out? How are you able to convert listings right now? How can you convince sellers to choose you over the other agents? What's your secret? I didn't expect an answer. And I had an agent said, I'm not telling everybody. I didn't expect you to, so let me tell you what you can do, how you can stand out. When you walk into the door of a listing appointment, you're not walking in talking about CMAs and marketing and virtual tours and how much money they're going to net. You're walking in saying, let's talk about how to keep you safe, your possessions secure, and your family safe while your house is on the market. You don't know who's going to be walking through, so let's talk about it. So this is where you get the opportunity to tell them all pictures on the wall come down. No personal pictures at all. Now what I hear is agents tell people that all the time. You tell sellers that, and the seller's thinking, I still live here, I want to feel like I'm at home. So you're telling them, no personal pictures at all, I can't control who's coming in, and that also means no schedules, no soccer schedules, no church schedules, any information that shows where your kids go to school, where you spend time, depersonalize the house, and assure your sellers that you can't control who's going to be in there. So you're doing this for their safety, and I guarantee you'll get a different result. The pictures will come down, they will depersonalize the house. You're going to also talk to them about getting jewelry out of jewelry boxes. You're going to tell them the value of hiding your valuables. Don't leave an empty jewelry box there, because if you do, they're going to do what? You're going to go look for the real jewelry, right? So I heard Barbara Corcoran say this. Leave some cheap costume jewelry in the jewelry box so it's not empty, so they don't go looking. But jewelry out of jewelry box, you're going to talk to them about medicine out of medicine cabinets. You're going to also tell them that the mail and pieces of paper, the little stacks of stuff laying around, get it out of sight. It can have medical bills. It could have financial information, just enough for someone walking through to steal their identity. So tell them, and it's aesthetically a good idea anyway to get all the clutter out, but tell them the safety reasons behind it. And again, you are the real estate agent talking to them about being safe, keeping their home safe. You're not talking about money and marketing. You're telling them that you care about their safety, and anyone who puts their house on the market, they're immediately concerned about strangers walking through their house. So here you are as a real estate agent saying, I care about your safety. Let me tell you how to keep your house safe. You're also going to talk to them about who to let in and who not to let in. You'll talk about lighting, locks, and landscaping, not just aesthetically. You're explaining to them why they need to have lights on, especially at night, and why they shouldn't have lights on in the daytime. Anyone tell me why? Why is it a bad idea if you say it's important and it's safe to have your lights on, your outside lights on, or your house lit up, whether or not you live there? And if someone says, oh, it's easier just to leave the porch light on all the time. Can someone tell me why that might not be a good idea? Exactly, they assume you're on vacation. So this is a conversation that you are having with the sellers. You are telling them that you truly care about keeping their house safe. Now, you don't have the listing yet, okay? But I bet you by the time you end the conversation, you have an edge because you're saying things that they won't say out loud. You're going to talk to them about the difference between a single cylinder and double cylinder deadbolt, which one is recommended. You're talking to them about landscaping, make sure it's cut back so that criminals don't have a hiding place. So you're walking through with this list and you're talking to them. You're also saying out loud that if someone comes to the door, even if they have a real estate badge on and they have someone standing next to them and they have a car that has their logo on it, if someone knocks on the door and says to your seller, I want to see the house, what do you tell your sellers to do right now?
Call the number on the sign,
and if you say that, you better be the agent who returns calls in a hurry, or else they're going to take a chance because they don't want to risk losing that client. What about telling them to tell the person who wants to see the property, I'm going to leave, I'm going to lock the door, and you can access it by lockbox. So therefore, they don't have to turn anyone away. If that's a real agent, they know how to get the lockbox combination, and then your seller leaves the house. So that's for their safety, and then that way they don't feel like they're going to miss out. So you're going to explain that if someone shows up on the porch, even if they stand there with a bag full of cash just dripping out, call me, call your agent. They're never ever to allow anyone in the house, and you need to say that out loud. And then, of course, you make sure that the doors are all locked up and encourage the clients to check after every showing to make sure everything is in good order. Again, I wrote an article about that. It has a link to the checklist that I created for you in order to help keep the seller safe. And I guarantee you, no other agent is talking to them about safety. And then here you are talking to them. That gives you an edge. You can also find that on the NAR website. Yes?
Can I throw in a couple other things to have them remove? Small electronic devices. People forget that their kids have iPads. An iPad is sitting on the bed. I've shown homes where I've seen so much electronic equipment that even if you're legit and you think your buyer's legit, they can easily pocket it. And then the second thing I run into a lot is actually money. I showed a house one time that I swear there was $300 in cash just sitting on the kitchen counter. So, it sounds like an obvious, but...
Exactly.
Especially if you're showing a rental list, not a rental property, but it's a property occupied by tenants. Sometimes that you need to make sure that your information conveys to the people who are actually occupying the property.
So right. Where should they keep those things during the showing? I mean,
what's the question?
For the homeowner, when you suggest
they keep it? He's asking where should they keep the stuff? Either take it with them. Or lock it somewhere. Lock it up in a file cabinet or something.
Or even storage. If you have, especially weapons. Yeah.
Sherry will put in storage for you.
Oh, where's Sherry? Oh, okay. So, excellent point. Get it off site. Get it in storage. If you have expensive artwork, if you have a gun weapon collection. I had an agent who took pictures of the property, that had a gun collection, and then he showed the open, it was advertising an open house. Everybody showed up to see the gun collection. Any weapons out of sight, expensive artwork, and you do storage units?
Yes, we do store.
Oh, perfect. So they can move the valuables out of sight. Good point. Thank you. So you can get that checklist from me, and again, it gives you an edge when you are showing the property. And then the listing appointment, that's probably the most important thing, is sharing that perspective with the actual sellers, because you're talking about things that others are not. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the agent. If you have a house to show and it has a fancy loft, or it has a man cave in the basement, and you're the agent who says, I don't go in basements and I don't do attics or loft spaces, how do you do that? How do you work around that? What's the proper way to show, the safe way to show, if you want to be able to show the whole property? Nothing ever blocks your escape route. The client always goes first. After a while, it's second nature. You can always let them leave. You can say, I'll stay here in the doorway. There's the bathroom, there's the closet. Go ahead and look around. Or you always have a tape running in the back of your mind. Never let anything block your escape route. So you can enter a room or space as long as they're in front of you and nothing blocks your escape route, so you can show what needs to be shown, but you need to take the time to make sure that you can get out if you need to in a hurry. I'm probably wasting my time to tell you all not to use your pictures on your materials, so I stopped saying that. I stopped saying that. Again, I have a twin sister. She's the girl who has our picture on her business card, and it's on her mailing. She does a little Kansas City Royals and Kansas City Chiefs mailings. Our picture's on there. So it's like, Stacy, why do you need your picture on your materials? Is it going to help you sell more houses, get more listings? Her answer is, I am my business. So no matter what I say to her, her picture's going to be on there. All I'm saying to you all is please make it a professional picture. That's all. I've seen some pictures. I've seen some things. Make it a professional picture.
Make it a current professional picture.
Professional picture means you're not doing your picture looking over your shoulder. What are you selling?
It should not be a glamour shot.
Yes.
Exactly. No glamour shots, just from here up. And I've seen things. Let me show you some things. So this real estate agent is in a bikini on a billboard. Her website business went from 2,000 to 20,000. She's okay with it. Male agents do it too. He says, whatever it takes to get the phone to ring. This agent got in trouble recently. He said, women use sex appeal, why can't I? So he's leading with sex appeal. Think about the consumer. Think about your, if you have a male client and his wife, and your male client's wife is going to be around this guy who thinks he's all that, it's going to cost you business. What if you're the sexy real estate agent who wants their husband around that? So not only from a safety perspective, but from a professional perspective, you need to make sure your image is professional. This is a Vegas a group of agents in Vegas. That picture on the top left is on their business card, and they got mad at me when I told them to not use suggestive pictures. That's the picture on their business card. This is their website, and it says, call our hotline to talk to some of our angels. What kind of phone calls do you think they're getting? Keep it professional. That's all I have to say. Keep it professional. Let us talk here. Got 15 minutes. Let us talk. There we go. Words to avoid in advertising. Criminals are looking for victims, and if they choose a real estate agent, now they need to choose a location. What words might you advertise with that would get them to think this is going to be good? What should you do? Say it again. Private, secluded, isolated, vacant. So be careful the words that you use. So let's talk about open house safety. How many of you all just absolutely refuse to do open houses no matter what's not happening? Oh, so everybody's going to do them. If you do them, you know you're not doing an open house to sell the house, right?
Yes,
you're doing it for what purpose?
Some are doing it for buyers.
Well, maybe things have changed a little bit, right? Lead gen. So you have to do an open house. Sometimes it's a necessary evil. So something that you can do before you host an open house is, first and foremost, if it's not your listing, tell the sellers the same thing you told your listings. Get valuables out of sight. Everything out of sight, and get the electronics and the things you don't think about, medicine, weapons, the jewelry, out of sight. Neighbors, knock on the door, go a little early, knock on the door on either side and across the street, hand them your business card, tell them you're holding the house open, and if they don't mind coming, to come over, and that's less time that you're alone, and then it's also a great business development tool. What if they need an agent, they don't know an agent? Now they know you know the neighborhood. And then you told them to help keep an eye out, they know you're safety aware. Agents, get your valuables out of sight. Don't leave them on the kitchen counter. That's purses, that's laptops, that's phones, that's tablets. Valuables out of sight because you cannot watch them. And then at the end, of course, lock up. And in the situation in Vegas, you want to make sure that there's no one left in the house when you're done. You want to make sure that no one's hiding in the closet. You want to make sure no one's left the window or a door unlocked for later entry. We talked about fair housing discrimination. Let's talk about how to keep the FSBO safe and how that benefits you. Who here loves when they see a FSBO sign? Who can't wait to call that FSBO? You do? Really? Do FSBOs like you?
Most of the time.
Most of the time, right. But do they like real estate agents in general?
No.
Do they respect real estate agents?
No.
Absolutely not. They think, I can put a sign in the front yard and do the same thing you're doing. Here's how you are serving your community. If you see a FSBO, you need to tell them what they don't know. I created a PDF for you. I want you to staple your business card to it, and then you pass this out to FSBOs. Mail it to them, hand it to them, stick it in their door. It's talking about the things we talked about today. Don't let strangers in your house. Make sure you screen them. Don't show alone. Put valuables away, things that they never, ever thought about. They thought, all I have to do is put a sign in the yard and sell this property. How hard can that be? Now you're giving them food for thought. By the time they get to number 13, they're thinking, oh my God, what are we doing? You know, this agent, your business card rises to the top of the stack. So, and again, you'll have the link to request this. This is a PDF that I created for you guys. Wrote an article about it. You can find it there. Okay, so let's talk about some of the lessons we learned from the pandemic. If you all never closed down, I don't know if you had to do anything different or was it business as usual, except you had to wear a mask.
Well, appointments became honored for the first time in the history of this area.
They what?
They came on. You had to make an appointment or you were getting in.
Right.
And whereas otherwise you had to drive by and just drop in, you know. No, appointments, scheduling appointments.
And you had to be serious. Oh, yeah.
Fast, yeah.
You had to be serious.
And also the COVID protocol, you know, masks and gloves and hand sanitizer.
Understood. And so often, and I just think about from
that was a boom for us.
The what?
That was a boom for us. COVID meant it's a lot of money because so many listings went off the market, but the buyers didn't go away.
Right. Right. Excellent. Excellent point. Thank you. So many places were completely closed. They had to learn to do a whole totally different way to do business. Some of the safety lessons, see there, I knew it was in there somewhere. Some of the safety lessons learned during the pandemic you have to continue, and one of those is virtually, working virtually, whether it's an open house or whether it's that virtual first meeting. NAR did a technology survey, and then they found the emergent technologies includes not only like drones, virtual reality, but they also talk about cybersecurity. So let's touch upon some of that. Okay. What do you think the number one tech tool was according to the survey? You guys would know. You would think so, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you think?
Zoom?
It wasn't. The number one tech tool was that e-signature.
Oh,
because you, I guess it depends on where you were, you had to close it. You had to use it. A lot of real estate agents have a budget for a monthly technology. What is it? $50 to $250 a month. And some brokerages actually pay money in this age of recruitment help keep their agents safe. So just depends on the circumstance. Oh. Why is my bill not clicking?
This is very ironic.
Okay, all cybercrime is a result of human behavior. In order to be a victim of cybercrime, you have to do something. You have to click a link, you have to download something, you have to open something, you have to share something. The only way to prevent cybercrime is what?
Not to do something,
but you need to know what not to do. One of the things that I find helpful is to pause, stop, and think before you take any action. Criminals are coming to us now via text message. So I got a text message one time that says, your PayPal password has been compromised. Click here to change it. My finger was hitting there. It's like, oh my gosh. And then it's like, pause, stop. Think about it. So I went to my PayPal account and I found out nothing was wrong. How tempting is it to click on a link, to download a link, especially if it says there's a problem with your order or you need to change your password? Don't do it, because that's how you let criminals into your systems, your information. Business email scams count for 5% of the fraud, but look at the dollar amount, $1.7 billion, even though it's 5%. Which industry do you think contributes to that $1.7 billion? The real estate industry. Even though it's only 5% of the transactions, think about the size of your transactions. So that's what makes up the $1.7 billion. So one of the things you have to do is to prevent crimes via email, because that's where they're occurring. That's where you get the email where it says, or your clients say, that says that you have a wire, a change in your wire directions, the wire fraud issues. One thing is, we all have Gmail, Yahoo, or Hotmail, whatever it is, because they're easy, right? Criminals think they're easy too. If you're doing business, you should not be doing business with a free email account. If it's Gmail, Yahoo, any of those, you should not be doing it. Your brokers probably should suggest, and if they don't suggest, they should mandate that you use your business domain email accounts for any kind of business work, and that's their business. Those listings, that client information belongs to the brokerage. So if you're out here on your laptop using email, Gmail, and your account gets hacked, and you have your client information in your email, you're going to have to call that client and say, sorry, my account got hacked, your information is there, I'm sorry. Is that okay? When criminals see if it's a real estate agent at Coldwell Bank or a real estate agent at Century 21, they know that those companies have IT departments. They know that it's likely that it's not going to be easy to hack those email accounts. When they see Yahoo and Gmail, they get excited. They think this is going to be easy. So you should use your business domain for your business email accounts. Okay, real estate fraud happened via email. And that's the way, that's where you have to be most safe to protect your email account. You need to learn how to recognize fraudulent emails. And it used to be in the olden days that you can tell a fraudulent email
because they were poorly written. Nowadays, criminals have Grammarly, they have spell check. This is a fake email account from Amazon. No typos, no errors, and there's that little link there, the hyperlink, so tempting to click. This looks like a Bank of America. Again, well written, you're thinking everything's fine, there's a logo, it's well written. You click the link, and then you're in trouble because you allowed them access to your computer. The bottom line is that you do not click on anything, you don't click on links. And again, here's how you lead with safety, talking to your consumer. You're going to talk to them about not wiring money to anyone. If you go to the NAR website, there is a disclaimer that talks about wire fraud. We'll talk about that really quickly as we wrap up here. But you need to know that email is the way that criminals have access to your information on your computer, and the only way they get into that is if you click a link or you respond or you download something. So that's 100% in your control. This real estate agent was using, I imagine, a Gmail or free email account. Someone changed a couple of letters in the email and they sent out horrible, racist, and horrible emails, and she said their goal was to destroy their business. If they would have looked to see a business domain, they would have assumed that there's an IT department where they couldn't do that. So you need to take it seriously. Zoom bombing is not a big deal anymore. How many of y'all have Zoom accounts? Almost all of us do. We had to have Zoom accounts, right? Zoom breaches, that's where the problem is. And people think that the dark web is some mysterious place and you don't have to worry about it. The dark web is where all of your Zoom, your information, your login, your email addresses go, and that's where criminals are shopping, looking for their next criminal. So what you need to do is you need to protect the information that's out there. How can you stop it? First of all, yes?
So going back to your point about everything comes out through an email, I have heard a couple of agents lately, people take, you know, we have information on our website, which is our phone numbers, everything that we're supposed to put out there. But then criminals are taking that information and they're pretending to be you and sending it out to people now.
That's why it's important to have that conversation to your clients, that you'll never, ever respond to an email that's asking you to do something, to send information or do something different. So that's a conversation you're going to have with your sellers as well as your buyers. You're saying it out loud. You know, never respond to an email looking for information from me. If it's coming from me, then pick up the phone and call me. Don't call the phone number or the email. But this is, again, where you're leading with safety, where you're having the conversation for them not to respond to that.
But what about when you're trying to lead generate?
When you're what?
You're trying to get leads out of the social media and all that.
We have to talk about it. This is where you need to know who you're working with. And I know you all have forewarned here. And people don't truly value what forewarned does. Forewarned allows you to take a phone number to confirm someone's identity. It allows you to get financial information if they have a bankruptcy or financial issues where they can't afford the house. And it also tells you if there's a criminal record. So any lead that you get, regardless of the source, you're going to get a phone number. You need to put that phone number in. One thing you need to know about forewarned is that it's going to tell you about criminal convictions. So what happens if you get that criminal who is, it takes sometimes 13 crimes before someone gets caught, I've heard. So what happens if you get the criminal who doesn't have a conviction yet? You still need to be concerned. But what forewarned will do, it will confirm the identity of whoever you get. If they're using a burner phone, it's going to let you know that, a temporary phone, a throwaway phone, it's going to let you know that. You have to make a decision, do I want to work with someone using a burner phone, or why are they using a burner phone, right? So it does that, and it confirms the identity. They're going to check and make sure that is truly the person who says that they are. So use that tool. And I got an opportunity to interview the forewarned guy. He said it takes 2 minutes, like at the stoplight, plug in the phone number and you get a report back. You get criminal convictions, any public records, so utilize that tool. Okay, on the bottom of the screen is haveibeenpwned.com. I want you all to not only write that down and do it yourself, but that's something that you can share with the consumer, your buyers, your sellers, potential buyers, haveibeenpwned.com, and there's no vowel in there. That's exactly how it's spelled. What you will do there is you're going to enter your email address, and then you're going to wait for the screen to populate with companies and websites that you visited that have had security violations. First time out, I had 13 of them. It includes websites like Canva, Poshmark, I think even Salesforce. So any site that you logged in, if they've had a violation where someone accessed their passwords, is going to tell you to change your password. Share that with the consumer. Say, hey, you know, you need to stay top of mind. So you need to say, hey, I just found out about this website. You might want to just check your email addresses. And that's an excuse for you to reach out to them, leading with safety. You're not asking for anything. You're not trying to sell them anything. That's a resource that you can share. Virtual showings, you all have had to do that. You need to be careful what you show in your virtual showings. If you're doing a video, you need to be careful not to show valuables. That means if there's a media room with expensive electronics, you don't want those visible. And you also need to be careful saying where you are, because you're thinking, I'm here, you know, I'm live, and you know Facebook algorithm tells you that you get more views if you're live, but you also need to know it's telling people where you are not. So be careful sharing your location. How many of you all are on Facebook? You need to make sure you know that your personal page is not a place to talk about business. Facebook will not allow it. You're getting away with it now, maybe posting your listings there. One day you're going to go to log in and your account will be taken down because you're violating their rules. Business goes on business pages. Do not talk about business on your personal pages. But the most important thing to know about Facebook is that social engineering is alive and well there. That means there are criminals trying to find ways to trick information out of you to get you to say things that you normally would not say. They're asking you post a picture of your recent picture and tell us your date of birth. And people are doing it month, day, and year. They're saying, what was your first car? What's your pet's name? What's your mom's middle name, maiden name? What street did you grow up on? If you get locked out of any account, you're going to get security questions, and they're going to be those exact same questions. What was your first car? What's your mom's maiden name? Criminals are finding ways to trick you into giving your personal information they need to steal your identity, so you need to be aware of social engineering. You all need to also be aware of cyber insurance. If your client is hacked or based on an email to you, or they send, if they're victims of wire fraud, there was a guy, a buyer, who sent $150,000 to his agent to close on a property, and it turns out he responded to a fraudulent link. So what? He sued the agent, he sued the lender, and he sued them for $150,000. If you can't write a $150,000 check or whatever the loss is, you're out of business. So you need to check into cyber insurance, and I'm trying to wrap it up here. We talked about wire fraud. Anyone know who that is?
Barbara
Corcoran. How do they describe Barbara?
Real estate mogul.
First of all, she's on Shark Tank, but how do they describe her?
A billionaire.
You don't want to cross Barbara, right?
No.
Barbara was a victim of a wire fraud. Her assistant wired $380,000 to pay an invoice. She didn't take the time to look at the email address and see that it was one or two letters off. With that kind of dollar amount, wouldn't you think she would take extra steps? She did not. But what she did know is that the FBI gives you a time, a window, like 72 hours. If you report it, you can get your money back. She got her money back. So it's a matter of knowing what you're doing. There are so many, and I'll promise, let me wind this up. There are so many websites that exist solely to share your personal information with whoever wants to pay for it. They can pay for it, they can get stuff for free. This is the tip of the iceberg. When I type my neighborhood, my address in, it's going to give whoever it is information about my house, my yard, how many bedrooms, how many bathrooms, who lives there, the value, even a map of my house. So when you're telling people on social media, I'm doing a live open house, you know, come see me today, you're also telling them where you're not, and they can figure out exactly where you live and so much information about you. All of you need to Google yourselves on a regular basis. If you are lazy and you don't remember to do it, set up a Google alert where you put in your name, comma, real estate agent, your name, comma, the real estate company. That way, if anything is ever published about you, you're going to get an email with a link to whatever's published. That way, you know exactly what's out there about you. Are you guys familiar with Craigslist frauds?
Yes.
Can you think of anything that I've said today that will help you? You can't prevent a Craigslist fraud, but you can get out in front of it with your seller. Can anyone think of anything that I just said that can help you with it?
A Google search?
A Google alert. What'd you say? A Google alert.
Yeah.
Set up a Google alert with all of the addresses that you have listed. If that address shows up anywhere published online, whether it's Craigslist or Facebook, if it shows up anywhere online, you get an email. And so that way you can get out in front of it. You can tell, hey, seller, you know, there's a problem. You need to contact Craigslist. Put a sign in your window that the house is for sale. So it allows you to be of service to your seller. You get out in front of them. So set up all of your listings inside of Craigslist. Okay, so we're just going to zip through. We don't have time to go through everything. Phone scams, you all are agents, you have to answer your phone. Whenever I see an out-of-the-area phone call, I'm excited because I'm thinking it's a client, but nowadays with all the robocalls, we don't want to answer our phones, and that could cost us business. There exists a product called RoboBlock that will physically not only stop the calls when they come in, that will keep them on the line, they'll kind of harass them, they'll call them back, so it teaches them an invaluable lesson. One thing I needed to cover is you mentioned Showing Time, you mentioned Home Snap, we talked about Forewarn. Those are apps that have safety features. Even your lockbox, your Sentry lockbox has safety features. All of them pretty much work the same way. They allow you to check in, and if you don't respond, then they're going to send within a certain time, they're going to send an emergency message to whoever your contact person is. Again, those are after the fact, a crime is in progress. So that's why it's important to use it as part of your safety protocol, but Forewarn is a proactive way to stop anything from happening before you meet a criminal, keeping in mind that it doesn't get the ones that haven't been convicted, so that's where you rely on your gut and your own research, whether it's online. Ransomware is in the news nowadays. You can do one simple thing to keep ransomware from closing your business. Can anyone tell me the one step that you can take with your information that will prevent a criminal from hijacking your information and saying, I'm not giving it back until you pay me?
Back it up.
You need to back it up. Use Carbonite or any other source. You can just simply back up your information. That way you can go on with your business and they're not holding anything of value. Again, the updates on your phones and your laptops, if you get something that says it's time to install an update, says the girl whose phone says it now, and I keep pushing, reminding, yep. Right? But whenever there is a security issue or problem with any of those sites, their job is to protect you. So they're going to send you an update to protect you. And when you put it off, you're only endangering yourself. Take the time, do the update, or schedule the updates to happen overnight automatically so you don't have to think about it. When you get that warning that your password has been jeopardized, you're going to see this when you do the haveibeenclone.com. When you get that warning, stop, check, and change your passwords on those sites that have been corrupted. I think I'm at the end here. We talked about cyber insurance. If you have an E&O policy, you need to ask your agent about a cyber insurance policy in case any of your clients get defrauded and they want to point the blame at you and you can't write that big check. Okay, I think
Tracy.
Anyone have anything,
Tracy?
Yeah.
That cyber, you talk about the your emails, right? And using a brokerage email versus a Gmail or Hotmail, that responsibility falls to the brokerage then for any of that protection.
Yes.
And if you're using Gmail or Hotmail, you're on the hook. So that's something to consider if you're using these free emails.
Everybody wants to wipe their phones off with one of those little web wipes. You can't do that, you will destroy your phone. So take a look at the screen, some of the ways to safely clean your phone and get rid of any virus, any bacteria, anything. Yes?
You said something about a 401, what was that about?
Forewarn. Forewarn, this is a benefit that your association offers.
Oh, okay.
So everybody, if you don't have the Forewarn app on your phone, there's no excuse. And one thing about Forewarn, so often we're concerned about the buyers that we're meeting, you know, let's check them out. What about the sellers that you're going to their houses and you're in the house with them and you haven't taken the time to check them out? Forewarn will allow you to do that. You can still do your homework, check property records, but that's one area we don't talk about enough to make sure that you've checked out the actual sellers who you're about to meet in an empty house. So we talked about safety apps, and most of the apps are reactive, but they're important. You need to make sure that you know the source. Get the app from the Apple Store or the Google Play Store. Don't just download apps from anywhere because that could be infecting your phone with malware. And at least those stores take the time to try to make sure that the apps are good. Harassing phone calls, as simple as making sure, you're reporting them to the authority, whether it's your real estate company and your association and board. Don't just block it and ignore it. In Houston, there was a woman who got an agent who was getting these harassing phone calls, and she reported it to law enforcement. They found that 100 other agents were getting harassing phone calls, maybe the same person, maybe not. So because she reported it, they were able to detect a trend and notify everyone else. So make sure you share that. I talked to you about ways to keep your seller safe and the FSBO safe. Buyers, if a buyer asks you whether or not a property is safe or neighborhood is secure, what can you do? Absolutely nothing. Right, you can't answer it legally. That's why you direct them to a resource like spotcrime.com. Tell them to go to the police department to ask about that specific property. Get statistics, get information, because you cannot legally answer it that way. It's on them to keep it safe. We're actually at the end. We talk about self-defense options, self-defense tools. That's the designation. Anyone have any questions, any lessons learned today? Yes.
My question is, what do you think about the jewelry that's like personal alarms where you can wear a necklace around and then press it, it's connected to the police department?
Great question. Invisaware is the big one, and I have had an opportunity to interview them as well. It's reactive, but they did add a feature that makes it less so. So the bottom line with that app and so many other safety apps is you push a button, and then it calls for help, and it sends the police. It's sending them to a crime scene. What Invisaware has done, they work with ADT. What they have done is they've enabled a live option. So if you're in a situation, you're feeling a little weird, someone's bothering you, you can activate, a live voice will come on, and you're not alone. So you can say, hey, you know, I've got my safety partner here, and then all of a sudden, they know that there's a potential witness, so you can get help before something happens, but so many apps are reactive. It's kind of pricey, but it's worth the investment. I just talked to someone who has it, and her battery ran down, so she has to get a new battery, but she's had it for a year. So whatever you can do to keep yourself safe, any option, and as long as you're aware, as long as you're using it, and as long as it's accessible.
Yeah.
So okay, this is the Facebook page,
I just saw this line with all the security
the mace.
Where can I get that? I am a resource for that. So I am going to give you my link. Pepper spray can be fashionable. So I do sell those items. I've been selling pepper spray for 27 years. I had a store. So I'm a resource for safety tools, including the alarms. And I don't
also
think I put,
check our realtor store.
Yeah.
Do you have it here?
Yes.
It might be a
dazzle. It will be fancy, but it'll be a job.
Okay, so you can buy it here. Most important thing about the pepper spray is to test it before you need it. Take it outside. If you have the key ring sprays, you have about 8 to 10 1-second sprays, so don't worry about using them up at once. Take it outside, make sure it's not windy, give it a test spray, make sure it's working, and be familiar with the spray pattern, and they're good for 3 or 4 years. So test it before you need it. Excellent point. Anything else? Any other questions?
No, but before we close out, can I ask the people here, I want 3 people to say one thing they're going to be doing differently.
One I liked and I found helpful as far as business-wise sales is to give the sellers or go through the list of keeping their home safe once you first walk into their house.
Okay, great. Helps you differentiate yourself.
I need two more. What are you going to do differently?
Not use my Gmail account.
Perfect.
One more.
I'm going to set up the Google alert. I didn't know about that.
That's
really
wonderful. Wonderful. I saw another hand in the back of the room. Don't. Yeah, I'm on all. I want to make sure.
Look at me, working on my calories.
I'm going to use the Google Maps feature and sharing my location.
Perfect. Perfect. Okay, so my work is not in vain.
Yes.
No, thank you.
Okay, well, I want to thank you all so much. I hope I didn't talk too fast. Thank you all so much.
And thank you very much, Tracey, and thank you so much to our sponsors for this event. And please continue to be safe, and if you're going to be getting additional information, so be sure to follow up with that. Thank you.